Welcome to the show. My name is Eva Venari, founder of the Elevate Institute, and I'll be your host for today's podcast. When doctors say we don't know, it's an inclusive conversation, and so many are craving to share their stories and experiences, and today's guest is no exception. Today's honored guest is Christine Laria. She is a spiritual teacher, a clairsensory guide, energy healer, and sound channel. All these are so yummy. I love all this conversation already. So through her vibrational transmissions of presence, insight, and sound, she guides, uplifts, and inspires those who are choosing a fully enlightened embodiment of freedom and love. Beautiful. I love it. Christine, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Eva. It's great to be with you.
Yeah, those are all so very high vibrational and sometimes very lofty aspirations, but it sounds to me like you kind of approach them with a very grounded sense. And I'm curious to take that information and take your story, and I'm betting that they all do come together.
Yeah, I feel they do. It feels like one organic whole for sure.
Yeah. It's hard to reach those high vibrational places unless you have somewhere to ground it to. But I would love to hear more about that. And, you know, and having somebody on the show who, you know, has a personal experience, not just from a practitioner point of view, but as a patient, like this is where a lot of us started, is being in that place of being told you're incurable. And I would love for you to share what happened and what led up to that moment.
Thank you. Yeah, I'd love to share that. It was, it really truly was a launching space for my life as I know it now. I didn't know that at the time. Mm. I found myself with a lot of chronic pain, and it was sometimes walking the dog would make me cry. And I was a university music professor, and I would go to raise the lid on the grand piano for a rehearsal, and it was too painful in my body. So I thought maybe I had arthritis or something. I would be very young for that. I eventually went to the doctor, and she did an exam and told me I had a very clinical diagnosis of fibromyalgia. And then she told me that, she said, well, there is no cure, and it usually worsens over time, and we will try to manage your symptoms as best as we can. And I remember my thought, my inner response when she said that was, well, not for me. Like, thanks for the information, but that's just not true for me. So it was really that diagnosis and the continuing pain that I was in that led me to begin my search, which I know is true for so many of us. It's when we reach that spot where there don't seem to be answers that we dig really deep for really liberating answers. And that's what I did. And I do feel like the first thing that contributed to that healing was that I absolutely was 100% confident that my body could heal. I knew there was a solution. I knew there was a way. I just didn't know what it was. So I began searching and working with different kinds of alternative therapies and practitioners and all kinds of things. And one of those was a wonderful naturopath who also did acupuncture. And he said to me, well, you may want to eliminate these two things from your diet. They cause a lot of inflammation, wheat and dairy. And I thought, I don't want to eliminate anything from my diet. I like my wheat and I like my dairy. I was not very cooperative.
No, I hear some stubbornness here.
However, some weeks later, I signed up for a 2-week yoga detox camp where we went every morning at 6 a.m. And it came with an elimination diet. And by golly, suddenly I felt so much better. And then I was motivated. I was really motivated. So that was another pillar of the healing was looking at my own nutrition and my own diet. And really the third thing was diving into the deep inner work. My doctor had told me, she said, well, we will see this, an onset of this disease within 1 to 2 years of a major trauma. And I had one of my major traumas, and it was nearly unbearable, like those things are for so many of us. And I'm happy to talk about it or not if it's helpful. And I realized that was probably a factor. And so in my search for alternative ways to get at the root of what was in me and my relationship with my life and myself and everything around me, that truly led to everything that I do now in terms of guiding people and working at multiple levels, both with the person and the body, but also with the being that we are, with the presence, with the aspects of us people, you may call it your higher self. It's where for me the deepest healing lay, because I found that what we truly are, when we're in alignment and in balance with that, it heals everything. And that can be physical and emotional, but it's also that there's that spiritual component. And that was huge for me. And so it truly led me to what I do now.
And there's so much to say about all of that. I mean, I'm getting curious about a few things in particular. You know, of course, the traumatic moments that stop your life cold turkey in this moment of, I can't believe this is happening, makes you go into this place of an emotional stop life, you know, stop everything. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if in this process, do you feel like you were consciously aware that, I'm known certainly not as aware as you are now, but were you consciously aware that the trauma could have been related to your onset of symptoms?
Not at the time, not until she said that and I dug further. I really didn't have the consciousness that I have now at all, you know, and and in my situation with this particular event was my son, who was a teenager, and we found him actually hanging. He was dead. And yeah, and then with 8 minutes of CPR, we're able to get the heart going, and then arrived the EMTs, and he was in a coma and not supposed to live, and not supposed to wake up, and then not supposed to have any meaningful function. And actually, he has all of those. He's 28 now and lives on his own and supports himself, a beautiful person. And so it was one of those miracle stories. And yet I found myself bracing literally for, well, when does the next shoe drop? It was this relationship with life that's the most natural thing in the world when we've had such pain, which is to guard against it and to try to control and to do anything to keep it more pain from coming. And that I realized that was my relationship with half of my life. I was in resistance literally to anything that was painful, or trying to make sure it wasn't going to happen, or how could I organize things so I had a better chance. Well, resistance is really painful. And that's the part I didn't know at all. I didn't know I was in resistance to my life. I didn't know I was in fear of what could happen. And through that discovery and coming into presence with that, that all changed and shifted. Yeah.
So it's almost like, I hate to say that the event was a blessing.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I will say that 100%. No problem with that. Now, don't tell me that at the time. Don't tell me when I'm in trauma, hey, this is a blessing, you know, because that's actually not true then.
No.
And, you know, that's abusive to our sweet human part that's like, actually, no, this is no blessing. There's no gratitude here. I'm just suffering.
There's
a time for everything.
Yeah, it fast-tracked you into a place of where possibly you had wanted to be at a soul level before, but you needed, like, it's almost like the elapsed time of, well, there should have been a natural progression towards this awareness at some point. But since she's so behind, we're going to do this event. You know, I'm not really trying to be humorous, but that's kind of what it feels like, right?
I think that's brilliant, Eva. It feels exactly like that. It's like, well, in a way, I see my own cooperation at the soul level, which is, you know, here's what I'm really interested in, and I'm going to help get myself there. That's sort of where I was at the soul level. And at the human level, I was going, you know, the WTF, what is going on? Right, this is horrible. And yet I actually wasn't, I feel like at the level of soul, I was not going to get here to where I am now. I was not going to be in this space of presence and awareness and service. That was part of my path. And so, yeah.
The crack of the whip from the universe, it stings.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, and it's interesting that the one thing you're trying to push away, right, what we resist persists.
Absolutely.
In the emotional pain, it ended up being the physical pain that you had to endure.
Yeah, and that became my great motivator and my guide, you know, and that's something that I find a lot is the very thing that we think of, and I know this is so, you're so aware of this, but whatever seems to be the problem, if I can receive that as the most direct information and as my master guide, all the information's there that I'm interested in. I mean, it may show up in 1,000 different ways, you know, again, because we're these complete beings of body and mind and soul and emotions, you know, and it's all those avenues. But absolutely, it was my master guide for sure.
Yeah. I mean, there was a natural progression. People talk about mind, body, spirit, and they say it separately. And I'm almost over the concept of those three words put together in marketing. When I see it, I almost cringe. I'm like, there is definitely a mind, body, spirit, but there is some sort of beautiful progression without the boundaries that we place on where those things begin and end between each other that slowly allowed for you. It's like, if we're not going to get your attention spiritually, then we're going to get your attention emotionally. If we're not going to get your attention emotionally, then we're going to get, you know what I mean? Then we're going to do it physically. And at some point, you know, then who knows if you had resisted longer, what would have come of that for you?
Whew. Yeah. Grateful that wasn't the path.
Right. But this is a beautiful moment where I, you know, I mentioned it a few minutes ago. It sounds like you were really stubborn. It also sounds like your stubbornness was the means to the end. It was a tool that you used in order to find the solution.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think I was stubborn, and I was also, I really wasn't aware at many other levels that I had a choice. And I find that if we don't know we have other choices, we don't really have them. So like, I was given this one physical option, which didn't appeal to me, but all of these other pieces, I didn't really know until I know. And I feel that we can't insist that we have greater consciousness or awareness than we do. We're all doing our best in that moment, including the stubbornness. Like you said, that can serve too. There's really nothing that can't serve and guide. It's just how much, really, it's just how much discomfort do we want to endure along the way?
None, absolutely none.
None, let's go for none.
I know, and a lot of people do that. I came to realize this a long time ago, is that people are suffering their way through, just give me something to make the pain stop.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now I want to turn my attention to these vibrational transmissions of presence. You know, we talked a little bit about insight and sound, and I want to hear more about what this was and how you used it to help your healing.
Oh, yeah. So wonderful. Well, I had the great honor of working with a number of really wonderful energy healers. Some of the most gifted people on the planet were in my backyard. And so I started by receiving, which was great. And so that was part of it. You know, I needed to be in a position where I was willing to be helped and people could help me. And I did that, which then of course led quite naturally to my own practice. I'd been working with energy for a while in various modalities. And then I realized, like, through the course of my time as a university professor, where my heart was really guiding people to their own freedom, to their own absolute, unbridled, true, powerful expression and experience of themselves, both as a person, but also as really, truly beyond the person. And so one thing led naturally to another, and I just kept pursuing the path. I realized all of my time, energy, and extra money was going toward everything that I was putting together, which eventually led me to a beautiful, it was called a life coaching certification. It's really consciousness guidance, more than just the nuts and bolts of life coaching, which it has in it. And then also in that pursuit encountered these amazing alchemy crystal singing bowls, which I now work with and I sell, and I make soundtracks for healing for people. And then the other part, it's so beautiful the way everything weaves together, was that I did have a career as a classical soprano, including, you know, Carnegie Hall and conducting.
Oh, wow.
I conducted orchestras and choirs on a national CBS special. So I had this whole classical music background. And that led to, my voice was highly trained, but then I handed that over actually through a journey where I went and worked with a shaman in Bali who kind of freed that gift in me. And then it became part of the energy work that I do. So the sound is both the voice and the bowls. And sound waves are amazing because they bypass our mind. They usher the brain into the brainwave states where healing happens more rapidly, like the alpha theta and delta. Mm-hmm. There's greater stem cell generation. There's greater cellular regeneration. And then I work with all that intuitively, along with other energy modalities that I've developed myself. So it was like every piece of life just dovetailed into this beautiful combination of what's here now. And the sound, like just even to this day, when I have something going on in my body, it's my first go-to because it's quick and it's powerful and I don't have to know what's happening. It just happens.
Well, how do you know which bowl? So I'm familiar with these beautiful crystal singing bowls and not knowing what level of intimacy our listeners have, but they're each of them are tuned, if you'll kind of explain, tuned to a note. Is that right?
Yeah, they are. They're all tuned to the notes of the scale as we know it, but they're in these sort of micro tunings because the bowls are born rather than, you can't say, well, you can't order it up like a car. Well, I want these features. They put a certain substance into the mold and they come out that size, but their pitch is anywhere from right at concert pitch to halfway to the next half step or the next note up. So they correspond to our energy centers. And then the alchemies that they put in them, everything from shungite to rhodochrosite to gold to platinum to amethyst to silver and lemurian seed, all these beautiful things. They each have vibrational properties that assist us in different ways. And that said, so there's a lot of science around sound right now, and there's a lot that you can discover and learn about these bowls. I still find that our own inner knowing is one of the most powerful guides. So that's how I work. Like, I know this information, but I also just tune into, gosh, it really feels like this sound or this bowl or this wants to come through my voice. You know, for me, the proof's always in the pudding with anything that we do. So I did an experiment and I called it on target transformational toning. And I asked people to give me an item that they'd like addressed with the sound. And so they would email that in. I would make them a track and send it. And I said, just listen for 2 weeks and tell me what happens. And it was nothing short of miraculous. It was astounding. I was blown away. Like, one woman had been hospitalized for extreme back pain and they thought she had a spinal infection and they never could diagnose it. She was there for 17 days and they eventually managed her pain and said, we don't know, and sent her on her way. Mm-hmm. And she listened to this for 4 days and her pain was gone and didn't come back. So yeah, it's a beautiful, powerful modality and I'm grateful for it.
It's definitely a co-creation between you and your connection with source and higher self and the magic of these alchemy of each of the bowls. Because I would imagine without your sensitivity to tuning in and listening to whatever message you need to hear in order to pick the right bowl and create the right arrangement of different bowls to orchestrate the sound for her person to listen to, like a prescription. It would not work otherwise. I mean, you can't just pick up a bowl and go, you know. In fact, you have one close enough to you that you could.
Oh, I do. And we'll see. Sometimes the sound on Zoom it varies. You let me know.
Well, let's see.
Yeah, we'll just find out. Let's see. I have one right here. This one is a beautiful note for the root and it's rhodochrosite. So rhodochrosite is really wonderful for healing any kind of woundedness or trauma or inner child things, also for relational issues, for sense of self and empowerment. It's just a beautiful alchemy. It sounds like this.
Is so beautiful. Hmm. Yeah, thank you for sharing. Yeah. There's nothing like having that experience, having gone through many different singing bowl experiences myself. It can travel. You can travel, you know, the astral travel and going on
the
journeys.
Absolutely.
Right. It just takes you out of planet. There you go. You're gone. And they're so very powerful. So,
yeah. Thank you for asking.
Yeah, absolutely. So while you put that away, I am just thinking about all the wonderful ways that people can experience you. And you're in lovely Hawaii. Oh, I'm going to get out my little violin, so far away. But but it, you know, today's technology, we can work with you no matter where you are.
Most of my clients are all around the globe. Yeah.
That's beautiful. Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm curious to know, you know, when it comes to your healing, you had you just worked with the bowls, the higher consciousness. What else did you do?
I did a lot of alternative therapies, and they included supplements and treatments of acupuncture and chiropractic, and a little bit less so with massage and meditative practices. Definitely worked with the bowls, definitely opened up into my own. There was a deep dive really through the traumas and the wounds, and coming out the other side to where, I mean, truly I can talk about what happened with my son, and there's no charge. There's none. There's no residual. There's no PTSD remaining. And that was part of my own inner work. So it was the whole thing, Eva, you know, like, you know, we're such complete creatures. And I did all the aspects, supported the body, the mind, the emotions, the being, everything. But really the coming all the way through was, I really feel, was learning to live as presence rather than only person, as soul rather than role, because it's a much bigger space. And it allows everything that's hurting a space to be held and seen and received. So it was all of those things. Yeah.
Yeah. How did you, and I know the answer, but I'm going to ask it anyways. How did you know what to do and in what order?
Yeah, I follow. You do know the answer. Well, I very much followed my knowing, you know, I followed my intuition. Yes. And that was another part of my learning curve, which was I used to argue with my intuition, and I don't anymore because it's always right. Yeah, there's that stubborn thing again. And my my mind would think it knew better, and it never did. And I got to learn that. And now there's nothing that if I have a knowing, there is nothing I won't follow. Anything. It doesn't really matter what it is. And that's huge empowerment, because then we're living from wisdom rather than thought. It's a much bigger space. Yeah.
Oh, that was big. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Beautifully said. And for those who are just tiptoeing into the clairsensory world and learning about listening to their intuition, how can they discern information from guidance, from spirit, from the place where source has our highest good in mind, and the opposite of where you might be under the influence of someone else's desires, no matter whether it's earthly or off planet, you know, how do you discern that? And or what do you give a direction for that?
Yeah, I would love to share that. You know, I find that we all know what a vibrational yes feels like. It's our yes place, you know, like I give this example. If you're in the dressing room while they have been closed forever, you're trying on clothes and you're looking in the mirror and something in you goes, oh, yes. And you get a full on yes. You know what that feels like. And the rest of it is maybe or no. Like maybe you're trying to talk yourself into the outfit, or maybe you could put it with this or that. Well, for me, a yes is a yes, and a maybe is a no, and a no is a no. And I know what a vibrational no feels like. We all do. It's like, you know, you just have that. That's a no. So that's what I use as my guide. And then I know that if I'm flip-flopping, if I'm considering things, if I'm having doubts, that's my mind, because guidance actually comes in clear and steady and consistent. And, you know, there are easy ways to just sort of learn your own dialect with guidance, but generally it's peaceful and it's quite consistent, and anything variable or that feels anything else isn't it. So yeah, that's just a little hint there, or piece to get started.
Yeah, because tiptoeing into this world and growing your spiritual sense and the relationship you have with your guidance, it's so very personal, and nobody can step in and say, that's true or not. You become the captain of your own ship, and that's where it gets really kind of scary.
Yes, and also really empowering, because nobody knows you better than you. You're the only one who's with you from the moment of birth to the moment of death, in and out of this body. And we've all had that hindsight 2020. You know, I had that little sense. I just knew, but I didn't really pay attention. So we know it's there for all of us. It's right. Just, it's not going to yell at us. The mind is loud, and the world is loud. And our guidance is just quiet and steady.
Soft. Yeah. It tends to have a feeling, in my experience, of almost like grandmother energy. It's very comforting, and we're here to help you. It's like a mm-hmm. consoling type energy for me. Everybody, I think has a different a different experience, but in learning what it is, you can then recognize it too. And you know, when you're staring down the nose of a doctor who's telling you you're incurable, going all the way back into that moment, what would you tell people who are feeling hopeless and discouraged in a moment like that? What would you say to them that would help give them hope again?
I would say to hold that space of more options. I know there are more options. I haven't found them yet, but there are more options. Because that simple allowance, it's like what activates our guidance. If you say, well, okay, I'll agree or allow that I have it, it will activate more. And if you simply hold the space of, I know I don't know it yet, and I know I'm tired, but I know that there is a way, because there's always a way. And then I also ask to be shown. I ask to be guided. It's like, well, show me. I'm willing. I'm open. Please show me. Whoever it is you like to speak to in that, you know, whatever that source of wisdom and care and love is. I was blessed enough to work with a doctor who, once I came back and had no more pain, she wanted to know exactly what I did, and she took notes.
Oh, I've never had that. I wish I'd been there. That's amazing.
Yeah.
And what a wonderful way to be humble and know that, hey, one, I didn't have all the answers, and two, but you found something that worked for you, and maybe I can help someone else. That's a beautiful space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really appreciated that.
Yeah. Okay. I appreciate that a lot. Just by observing it. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's a good energy. Yeah. And there can be more. Let's say yes to that and more of that.
Absolutely.
Let's have that.
I say yes, please, more of that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So in listening to your story and knowing that you have these beautiful bowls to work with and the life coaching, do you have anything that you'd like to share with our clients, and how can they get a hold of you?
Oh, I'd love to. Yeah. All of your beautiful listeners, and so grateful for what you do too. The easiest way would be at my website, which is just myfullname.com. So christinelaria.com. And there's a couple free gifts that if you just scroll down on that main page. And one is a beautiful 10-minute sound transmission. It's very peaceful. It's called Peaceful Heart. And it has lovely Hawaii nature sounds, and it's beautiful. There's also actually included in that is a free masterclass on conscious dreaming. And I found that the conscious dreaming space helps us access our deeper wisdom and knowing for our answers and guidance from all the sources that we trust, and including from within our own masterful self. So those two are in there if they'd like to just check that out. And then there are links on that page, of course, that will take you to the bowls and all sorts of things, if whatever you want to explore. But that's a nice way just to see what it feels like. What I do, and it's free.
Wonderful. Well, thank you. And we're going to have the links to your website and those gifts available on the show page. So not to worry if you're driving and are missing out on that. Just go to theelevateinstitute.com and follow the menu items to the podcast, and you'll see Christine's interview with all that information listed for you nice and neat. So
wonderful.
Yeah. So I wanted to say, you know, I ask all of my guests one final question. And I'm going to ask you, you ready?
Yeah.
What do you feel is the most important thing to remember when searching for answers?
That truly you are the master that you seek, and what you fully are, it heals everything.
Very empowering. Beautiful. Well, any other final words that you would I mean, I don't know how you can top that, but I'm asking for some reason. So,
because I want to be able to tell you how grateful I am for you and everything that you do and all the listeners. And I'm so grateful and honored to be with you, Eva. Thank you.
Oh, well, thank you. See, I knew there was a reason I was asking.
There it is.
Something was like, ask her another thing. Okay. Well, I want to thank you for being a guest on today's podcast, Christine. I so appreciated this conversation. It's been juicy and fun.
So, likewise.
Yeah. And thank you for listening in on today's podcast. When doctors say we don't know, this has been an engaging conversation. And my goal for those of you hearing is a message of hope so you too can turn your experience of pain into triumph. If you're driving or simply can't click on the links to the show notes, remember you can always hop onto the elevateinstitute.com and follow the podcast links for today's show. There's more to talk about. Tune in next week for a new episode of When Doctors Say We Don't Know. This is Eva Venari reminding you to question everything.